This video is sponsored by Private Internet Access VPN. On February 24th of 2022, a group of Ukrainian soldiers guards a checkpoint close to the border with Russia. The group consists of five young soldiers, under the command of a sergeant, Denis Tkach. Denis is due to be relieved from his duties the next morning, and this is his last shift. At 3:40 a.m., using thermal imaging goggles, one of the soldiers spots movement in the snow. It's a Russian advance force. Behind them, an army about to start the biggest invasion on European soil since World War II. A decision has to be made. Should they stay in defended position, or should they retreat? Denis makes a decision. He orders his five men to quietly but quickly retreat from position to get out of danger. He's the last one in the hut and he decides to grab hold of their only machine gun to defend the position. It's at this moment that the Russian group realize they've been spotted and open fire. Denis was 36 years old and had a wife and two children. He's believed to have been the first casualty of the war in Ukraine. After almost 2 years of fighting, the casualties continue stacking up for both sides. This video is not about the politics of the conflict, it's about the people affected by it. We're going to be looking at the scale of the conflict and its impact on human lives. Russia invaded Ukraine in February 2022, and since then, there have been a lot of numbers reported by the media. I don't know if you're like me, but I get a bit lost in all these numbers. I want to understand the scale of this war, but I can't read through all this noise. I couldn't find a video explaining this, so I decided to do my own research and make a video myself. So here's what I found. To understand the impact of this war on human life, we should understand how many people are involved in the first place. When the conflict started, Ukraine had a population of almost 44 million. In this visualization, each figure represents 100,000 people. Russia had a population of about 143 million. Before the invasion, Russia mobilized as many as 190,000 soldiers at the Ukrainian border. On February 24, they invaded Ukraine. This invasion triggered Europe's largest refugee crisis since World War II. By May 2022, over 8 million Ukrainians were thought to be internally displaced. Others chose to leave Ukraine. An estimate of 8.1 million refugees had left the country after 1 year of fighting. These were mostly women and children, but also an estimated 20,000 men who escaped Ukraine to avoid military conscription. The number of refugees and internally displaced people eventually went down as the situation improved in favor of Ukraine and many people returned home. As of today, the countries that hold the most Ukrainian refugees in the EU are Poland and Germany, with about 1 million refugees each. Outside the EU, the country holding the highest number of refugees is Russia. But there's a nuance here. It is estimated that over 1 million Ukrainian citizens were forcibly deported to Russia, a practice prohibited under the Geneva Conventions of 1949. This includes thousands of children abducted and forcibly adopted into Russian families. The Ukrainian government identified around 20,000 abducted children. The refugees are not only coming from Ukraine. There has been an exodus from Russia. An estimate of about 800,000 to 900,000 people have left the country since the war started. This includes political refugees, such as journalists. It includes thousands of men trying to avoid military service. In the 2 weeks after Putin announced a partial mobilization, 370,000 people left Russia. And it includes economic migrants. 100,000 of them are IT specialists, according to a Russian minister. That's 10% of all developers in Russia. It's debatable whether you can consider all of these people refugees. Nonetheless, if we decide to consider all this Russian immigration as refugees and stack them with Ukraine figures, we get a total of about 9 million refugees, making it the world's largest refugee crisis in recent history. And there are concerns for massive labor shortages in the future. The population loss in Ukraine is so severe that it endangers the reconstruction of the country. It's believed that the population will never return to its pre-war level. And Russia's brain drain is also expected to have damaging effects on the economy of the country. Now let's focus on the soldiers doing the fighting. Before the invasion, Ukraine had about 197,000 soldiers in the military and 102,000 paramilitary groups. As of September 2023, there were over 800,000 soldiers according to the Ukrainian Ministry of Defense. As the conflict dragged on, Russia also mobilized more troops. The number of deployed soldiers in Ukraine went up to 300,000 according to EU's foreign policy chief, and 420,000 according to Ukraine's intelligence. And now for the big question. How many casualties has this conflict caused so far? It is said that truth is the first casualty of war, and the numbers reported by the countries fighting can be biased, especially when it comes to casualties. In a study published in the PNAS, a peer-reviewed scientific journal, a group of journalists concluded that both Ukraine and Russia are likely manipulating these numbers. They made estimates for the reporting bias of each side, and found that both Russia and Ukraine are likely overestimating the losses of their opponents. They estimated that Ukraine multiplies Russian deaths by 2, and that Russia multiplies Ukraine deaths by 4. They also estimated that Russia is likely downplaying the deaths suffered by their own army, reporting only about a third of their own losses. Keeping this data uncertainty in mind, let's try to visualize the casualties of war. Casualties are the sum of the people killed and the people injured in war. Typically, for every death, there are multiple injured people. We're going to visualize both, starting with the military casualties of Ukraine. In June 2022, Ukraine reported 10,000 soldiers dead and 30,000 injured. 3 months later, Russia reported that Ukrainian troops had suffered 61,000 deaths and 49,000 injuries. They also claimed Ukraine's fatalities were 10 times higher than Russia's. In February 2023, the scientific paper I mentioned earlier estimated Ukraine's military losses to be at about 17,000 dead and 33,000 injured. In June, Ukraine launched a counteroffensive which raised the number of casualties significantly. In August, some US officials estimated Ukraine had 70,000 soldiers dead and 100 to 120,000 injured. Ukraine is reluctant to disclose its losses, even to the American government, which makes it hard to find good estimates. I leave it up to you to decide which data you trust, but I'm keeping these numbers in the chart. Now, let's look at the military losses on Russia's side. I found 3 reports from June 2022. Russia reported 5,937 dead soldiers. UK intelligence estimated the number was more than 15,000. And Ukrainian government claimed the number was 30,000. You can really see how the numbers change depending on who's reporting them. Later in February 2023, the scientific paper I mentioned earlier estimated the Russian losses to be at about 77,000 dead and 149,000 injured. In August, US officials estimated the numbers to be at 120,000 dead and between 170,000 and 180,000 injured. In October, BBC News Russian, together with Mediazona, a Russian independent news website, conducted a statistical analysis using data from Russian cemeteries and estimated that the number of dead soldiers could be higher than 88,800. 1 month later, Ukraine officials claimed the number to be at least 150,000 dead, with a total of 320,000 casualties, according to a Facebook post by an Ukrainian army official. Once again, it's up to you to decide which numbers you trust. But for my chart, I'm going to use the more conservative death estimate from BBC News Russian, and the injured estimate from the US officials, since it's the only recent number I could find that wasn't reported by one of the fighting sides. Now we get to civilians. In September 2022, the United Nations Human Rights Monitoring Mission in Ukraine estimated that at least 10,000 Ukrainian civilians had been killed and over 18,500 had been injured. They said the real numbers might be much higher due to the difficulties in verifying information. In February 2023, the study I mentioned earlier estimated about 13,000 deaths and 19,000 injuries. Many of these casualties happened far from the front lines, as Russian airstrikes targeted civilian areas across the country. According to UN, over 500 deaths and 1,000 injuries were children, and more than 300 deaths and 600 injuries were caused by mines or abandoned explosives. Many casualties were caused during the siege of Mariupol, which lasted for 3 months. Ukrainian authorities claimed that 25,000 people died in the city. The UN could only confirm about 1,300 deaths, but estimates the real number to be thousands higher. About 1,400 civilian deaths were reported by the Donetsk and Luhansk People's Republics. It's hard to avoid saying anything controversial here because both these areas were controlled by Ukraine until 2014, when paramilitaries supported by Russia created these republics. In 2022, Russia annexed these regions and now considers them part of Russia. Since they're not internationally recognized as such, I decided to show these casualties on this section of the chart. Local sources blame these casualties on Ukraine. On Russia's side, there have been at least 105 deaths according to 7x7, a Russian independent news website. Most of them were the result of artillery strikes close to the border with Ukraine. If we stack up these numbers, we get a total of almost 500,000 casualties with 172 deaths and 300,000 injured, give or take, depending on who's counting. Many of these injuries were permanent. Over 20,000 Ukrainian soldiers have lost limbs, as well as, according to Russian minister, over 50% of all Russian soldiers wounded severely enough to require medical examination. Thousands of people that are not on this chart also face long-term psychological trauma as a result of their experiences, including several human rights violations. Now let's take the total death toll and compare it with the remaining wars of the 21st century. I have to admit, I was surprised by how many wars have already happened since the year 2000, and I'm only showing the wars that caused more than 50,000 deaths. The war in Ukraine, as of today, is far from being the deadliest war of the century in absolute terms. However, we should keep in mind that the war only started in 2022. If we adjust the chart to show the average number of deaths per year of conflict, then you could make a case that the war in Ukraine might be the deadliest war of the 21st century, with almost 100,000 deaths per year. The war in Ukraine doesn't make it to the news as often, and it's easy to forget about the millions of lives affected by the conflict. This video was my attempt to understand the dimension of this war. I honestly don't have a key conclusion for this video. There's a lot of politics at play, and it's not my place to tell you how this war should end. But this research helped me personally understand the numbers of this conflict, and I just hope you found it useful as well. A video like this takes a long time to produce, and with such a sensitive topic, there's a risk of the video being demonetized by YouTube. This production was only possible thanks to today's sponsor, Private Internet Access VPN. When you browse the internet on a public network like a coffee shop or even using an unencrypted network at your own home, you're exposing your data to hackers, your network administrators, the government, and more. Basically, anyone has the ability to steal your personal data. A VPN hides your IP address and safeguards your internet connection through an encrypted tunnel. Private Internet Access is one of the most trusted VPN providers in the market with a really easy to use interface. It takes half a second to switch it on. Also, if you're trying to use websites or services that are blocked in your region, you can use it to change your IP address to locations in 84 countries, including all 50 US states. This was particularly useful during the research of this video, since many Russian sources are blocked in the EU. And you can also use it to watch TV shows that are not available in your region, on Netflix for example. If you use my link in the description, you get an 83% discount, which adds up to only $2.03 a month, and you also get 4 extra months completely for free. Thank you for watching. If you like stories told with data and would like to support my work, consider leaving a like and subscribing to the channel, and thank you to our patrons.